All we want to do is take the chains off. All we want to do is take the chains off. All we want to do is be free. All we want to do is be free. All we want to do is take the chains off. All we want to do is break the chains off. All we want to do is be free. All we want to do is be free.
So now it's like the officer's pulling him inside the car. He's trying to pull away. And at no time the officer said that he was going to do anything until he pulled out his weapon. His weapon was drawn and he said, I'll shoot you. So I'm going to shoot you. And in the same moment, the first shot went off. And we looked at him. He was shot and there was blood coming from him. And we took off running.
Are we all alone? Fighting on our own. Please give me a chance. I don't wanna dance. Something's got me down. I will stand my ground. Don't just stand around.
Well, Sheree, good evening to you, and I can tell you tonight that police shot dead 22-year-old John Crawford last night in Beaver Creek. He lived here at these apartments in Fairfield, and we just got done talking with his family. They tell us that he was only holding on to a fake gun last night. Now, Beaver Creek police near Dayton tell us officers responded to a Walmart store last night for a man waving a rifle-type weapon at customers. We're told officers confronted Crawford and that he did not listen to their verbal commands. He was then shot by police. Crawford died after he was taken to the hospital. The mother of his two children says she was on the phone with him the entire time.
This is for the police that you weren't listening. He was telling you that it wasn't real. The gun wasn't even real. And he just lost his life. From the police.
I'm here today to let everyone know that my son's name, along with the rest of these families, will be vindicated. I worked under this system off and on for almost 20 years under the criminal justice umbrella. And never before have I been so ashamed. But the same system that I carry out my duties is the same system that I'm receiving injustice for.
To deliver justice, just as I suspect Judas must have. Not knowing that the imperial powers had corrupted the system for their own interest, not for justice. How could he have known, Father? Forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Greed, of course, was a contributing sin. Perhaps underlying Judas' motivation and the greed of the priestly elite threatened by Jesus' teaching on the scripture. Their own tool turned against them, challenging their power, prestige, and profit. Walmart surely is culpable here. Just because firearms sell doesn't mean you should sell them real or otherwise, but contributing to a culture of violence holds no weight against an obsession towards improving the bottom line. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And I stood there, silently weeping amidst the murderous crowd, never condemning Jesus nor denying him, until I learned that's not how it works when you're staring in the face of injustice. To have your eyes open to injustice repositions your place in the story. Your point of view shifts completely. And as I came to learn more, read more, listen more, pray more, I found out that every time I crossed the street as a young black man approached me on the sidewalk, every time I started or heard a sentence begin with, I'm not a racist, but, every time I laughed, no matter how uncomfortably, at a racist joke, every time I just didn't notice yet another syllabus in front of me was nearly completely composed of dead white men, every time I explained my parents raised me colorblind, every time I failed to correct the racist assumptions of my parishioners, every time I stood silent cross. And a young father holding a fake gun when he's dead on the ground. It's not real. You were right, John. None of it was real. No aggression, no crime, no reason, no due process, no indictment, no trial. The gun was not real, the crime was not real, and for you, justice is not real. But I know now that it's real. Our guilt, our anger, our grief, our greed, our fear, our complacency, our silence, our sin, all of it is real, very real indeed. All of it struck his body with a bullet, with a nail. Father, forgive them, for they don't know. Father, forgive us.
In Brooklyn. She was driving a car, police say she stole a gunpoint. They say 23-year-old Chantel Davis drove through three red lights yesterday before striking a minivan in East Flatbush. After she crashed, Davis allegedly hit Officer Philip Atkins with the car door, then put the vehicle in reverse. Officer Atkins reached inside to put the car in park and fired a single shot. Davis was hit in the chest and it killed her. The NYPD now investigating whether he meant to pull the trigger.
Holding on, what the hell going on? Do you know who you are? Do you know who we are?
We. The 23-year-old woman then dove back into the car. She tried to back it up. That's when a second cop entered the car from the driver's side. With his gun in his right hand, he tried to put the car into park. Seconds later, a single shot rang out. It hit the woman in the chest. She's dead.
Rigby shifts from the mocking of Jesus by the soldiers and onlookers to now mocking by a fellow that is being crucified alongside of him. It is here that a conversation ensues, and although Jesus is often ridiculed for conversing and convening with sinners and thieves, these are familiar conversation partners under unfamiliar circumstances. However, the result of this conversation is the promise of paradise made affordable to one thief, while the disillusion of eternal life for the other thief is certain. Before that climatic conversation can take place between the thieves and Jesus, one thief allows his current situation and circumstance to dictate the ways in which he chooses to live out his last moments of life. I have no doubt that all three individuals on these crosses desire to live. However, the text highlights three lessons for us to consider how we should respond in those moments when your life is nearing an end and we are faced with difficult decisions. If we want to live, number one, we cannot allow our sentence to affect our sanity. We cannot allow our sentence to affect our sanity. Verse 39 of Luke 23 says, one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. Verse 40 says, but the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same. Although this thief is sentenced to rot, to decay, to decompose, wither, spoil, to die a slow and agonizing death, he has not allowed his current sentence to cause him to speak carelessly or flippantly about Jesus. Had this been some of us, we would, if we were to be honest, we would be up there cussing, trying to cut deals, trying to find a way off the cross, if we were to be honest, and saying anything we could say to better our situations. If this had been us, we would have literally lost our minds. Here it is. The other thief didn't lose his mind. He didn't go crazy. Instead, he had a keen sense of awareness and sensibilities were increased. And he said to his budding rival, "Do you not fear God?" As if to suggest that he had really good sense and an understanding of faith to recognize that he was in the presence of the very one that had the authority to offer him forgiveness and mercy, even as he hung as strange fruit from the poplar trees. If we want to live, we can't allow our sentence to affect our sanity. But number two, we can't allow our bad experiences to cause us to be better. We can't allow our bad experiences to cause us to be better. Verse 41 says, "We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man, has done nothing wrong." What I like about this nameless thief is that he not once blamed someone else for the current circumstances that he found himself in. However, in the midst of his persecution, he becomes a proponent for the mission of Jesus Christ. He becomes a model, and not only a model, but a benefactor for the justice and what mercy looks like, not just for himself, but also as an apologist on behalf of Jesus Christ. While the other thief is degrading Jesus' divinity, this thief is rallying for Jesus' righteousness. He recognizes that just because he's in a bad situation, that does not mean that he has to be bitter towards someone else that had absolutely nothing to do with why he's there in the first place. In other words, my mother would say, "Hurt people hurt people, and misery loves company." It is here that I'm called to consider that maybe the individuals that are so agitated and hard-pressed to abolish that which they see as a threat to their standards of living is indeed battling some skeletons of bad experiences and bitterness in their own lives. If we want to live, we can't allow our encounters and our fears of something or someone to continue to drive us to kill that which what God is still developing. If we want to live, we can't allow our sins to affect our sanity. We can't allow our bad experiences to cause us to be bitter. But thirdly and finally, if we want to live, we can't allow our crimes to separate us from Christ. We can't allow our crimes to separate us from Christ. Verses 42 and 43 says, "Then he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' Jesus answered him, 'Truly I tell you today, you will be with me in paradise.'" One witness reported in 2012, "Call the ambulance. Please don't let me die. I want to live." Is what 23-year-old Chantel Davis said as the Toyota Camry she stole and crashed allegedly became her cross, her very own ditch and tree, and the place where the probability of her passing would become imminent. Even in this moment, she has enough wits to employ that which has the power to rescue and relieve her of her social illnesses and offer the promise of paradise, much like the thief on the cross alongside Jesus. Chantel's cry for an ambulance is not a mundane call for help, but rather it is a prophetic sentiment that pushes us to consider how even those individuals society has marked as beasts, savages, and menaces seek to have life and life more abundant.
attached to that which the ambulance represents. The ambulance represents hope. The ambulance represents anticipation. The ambulance represents the desire to be made whole again. However, the ambulance isn't meant to stay stationary or remain the main part where the triage center is located. The ambulance's sole purpose is to transport broken, bleeding, bruised, and conflicted individuals from one location to another. The good news here is, while the ambulance is transporting injured individuals from one location to another, there is an EMT on board working to alleviate the pains caused by self and society. There is an EMT on board working to mend broken families affected by the wrongdoing of persons just and unjust. There is an EMT on board working to reconcile those who we have convicted based on our own moral compasses. I'm so thankful that the wounded EMT, Jesus, is not like many of us during moments of agony and trauma. The wounded EMT doesn't offer a trivial response to the thief's 911 outcry, but he offers a prudent and tactful resolution. He says, "Truly I tell you, you will be with me in paradise," as if to suggest that he really means what he is saying and genuinely this thing. Life is valued so much so that he can have life after death in paradise. Jesus is calling us to stop being subjective EMTs when we are called to rescue and revive all people. We can no longer play God through our particular prisms of privilege, our badges and our titles, and decide whose life is expendable and whose is not. This random yet subtle conversation serves as a reminder that we should do mercy and offer grace to all persons, because all lives matter to God, even when they don't matter to us.
God help us. Time to take a stand and save our future.
Like we are God's shot, we are God's shot.
Throwing up our hands, don't let them shoot us.
Cause we are, we got, we are, we got. God ain't put us on the earth to get mad, it's murder. God ain't put us on the earth to get mad, it's murder. Don't put your weapons at me.
Seen the pictures, feel the pain. Scandalous how they murder son. Tired of them killing us. I'm on my way to Ferguson. Talk to Tip, I talk to Diddy. Then my brother's walking with me. Mother's crying, stop the riots. We ain't gotta chalk the city. I seen Cole out there. Felt I should go out there. They left that boy 4 hours in the cold out there. They killing teens. They killing dreams.
It's murder.
Yo, come on. We gotta stick together, we all we got. When police taking shots and I ain't talking about Ciroc, I'm talking about Emmett Till, I'm talking about Azelle Ford, talking about Sean Bell, they never go to jail. Vaughn over Skittles, Mike Brown, Cigarello. Story keep repeating itself like a Biggie instrumental. America's a glass house and my revenge is mental. Rather use my brain and throw a cocktail through a window.
I got the keys to the city, still we left in the cold. Hands in the sky, still was left in the road. Ribbon in the sky, Michael Brown, another soul. Stole by the system, black men, we pay the toll. The price is your life.
As the mother of Amadou Diallo, who suffered a terrible loss, many people would have think that I have hatred and desire for revenge. But in my heart, I have no hatred and I have no desire for vengeance. So I want to send a message to them that you can take your anger and your frustration, turn it into something positive, and do something that can bring people together.
The governor of Utah just signed a bill which legalizes the use of the firing squad as a form of execution. Of the 50 states in the Union, Utah and Oklahoma are the only two that have legalized the firing squad as a way of taking life. And yet when we look at the news, we have to wonder if the firing squad has been legalized in all 50 states. America has an obsession. An obsession with vigilante, state-sanctioned killings. State-sanctioned killings aren't new. Jesus was charged for a crime he didn't commit. Betrayed by a confidential informant. Sentenced by a politics-hungry judge. And nailed to the cross by an angry mob. Some lament there was no innocence project to pull Jesus off the cross. And yet, as he hangs from the cross, he makes a dying declaration. He says, "Woman, here is your son." He has to acknowledge his humanity in order to bring solace to his mother. Mary had been there at the foot of the cross, spending time sitting with her son Jesus. Jesus had to create a space for her to see more than just a crucified Christ. He had to let her see her son so that she could mourn. She had wrapped him in swaddling clothes, fed him, bounced him on her knee, cleansed his scrapes and his bruises, watched him go to the synagogue to learn, turn water into wine. She saw her dreams for him dying on the cross. Katie Diallo had dreams for her son. When Abu called her on February the 4th, 1999, he told her, "Mom, I'm going to college." Words of promise, words of aspiration. I can feel her heart swelling with emotion. He labored for 2.5 years, working 12 hours a day, selling videotapes, gloves, socks on New York City sidewalks. Snow, rain, sleet, cold, heat. He persevered and he saved $9,000. When they lived in Asia, Amadou studied at the Microsoft Institute because he wanted to become a computer programmer. And so now here he was at the precipice of a dream that had been deferred. And then that evening came. After a late meal, Amadou was standing on the front of his apartment house steps when suddenly 4 plainclothes officers from the Street Crimes Unit approached. The Street Crimes Unit, they had a motto: "We own the night." What happened to protect and serve? When they saw Amadou, they claimed he matched the description of a serial rapist. There's one problem. The serial rapist was already in custody. So here is Amadou, standing in front of his home. 4 men, none wearing uniforms, all believing they owned the night, moving towards him at 12:40 a.m. in the morning. So he moves towards his apartment door. They claim to have yelled NYPD. They claim to have yelled, "Show your hands." In that instant, what would you do? It's 12:40 in the morning. You're standing in front of your home. 4 men you don't know run up on you until you stop, freeze. And you're in front of your home. Would you stop and freeze? Or would you be apprehensive? Would you begin to move back and wonder, what are these men for? They're not wearing uniforms. Maybe they're trying to set me up. So Amadou, trying to be a good citizen, went to reach for his wallet so that he could show identification, that he actually belonged where he was, so that he could show that this was his address. An officer yells, "He has a gun!" 41 shots later, his dream is dead. Amadou's body lies torn to shreds, 19 full metal jacket bullets, shredding his body, his limbs apart. His blood warming a cold apartment complex vestibule. At least Jesus had a trial. Not Amadou. No judge, no jury, no crime. Just executioners. Amadou was given to his mother to be buried. "Woman, here is your son." And in his death, no mention of his aspirations, no talk of his dreams, never once hearing the phrase "aspiring computer programmer," "soon to be college student." Instead, they turned him into a caricature. He became the African street peddler. the African street peddler. It's a phrase that we should be somewhat used to in our context, even in an era of color blindness. The stereotype still lives. Atlanta Hawks GM Danny Ferry said Sudanese-born NBA player Luol Deng was that kind of African. You know, the one who owns a store but sells counterfeit merchandise out the back. Despite Deng's tremendous philanthropy, even he is still an African street peddler. So it shouldn't surprise anyone that 15 years ago, Amadou's humanity was deconstructed and relegated to racial and cultural tropes. Because the state doesn't execute humans. If you don't see victims as humans, then the state did nothing wrong.
That's right.
Woman, here is your son. Since the state does no wrong, they move the trial of the four state-sanctioned executioners away from the community, away from the people who seek justice, away from the place where justice was due. They moved it to Albany, New York to ensure a fair trial. A fair trial for who? 145 miles and a cultural continent away from New York City. Away from the Soundview section of the Bronx where Amadou was gunned down. Where was the fair trial for Amadou Diallo? Where was the justice and righteousness for Brother Diallo? Where was the mishpat in Sadiq? The justice and the righteousness for him. Four indictments, no convictions. No justice for the street peddler. Woman, here is your son. Unlike Jesus, for Amadou there was no second act. No third day resurrection. No glorious reunion. No sitting at the right hand of God. No revival of a dream deferred. Just another victim of vigilante state-sanctioned killing. Mom, I'm going to college. No, Brother Amadou, you did not go to college. Instead, you went to the grave.
When police arrived, both men ran in different directions. Police say McDade reached for his waistband, and believing he was armed, both officers fired their guns. McDade was rushed to Huntington Hospital, where he later died. During the investigation and under pressure from investigators, Carrillo finally admitted he lied about the gun.
Possibly speak tongue, beat drums, Abyssinian Street.
Kendrick McDade died with a question on his lips. Why? Why did you shoot me? He asked the EMT who was attempting to save him as he bled out on the street. His young black body pierced by 8 bullets fired by 2 guns by 2 Pasadena police officers. 8 bullets, 8 holes, 1 for each time a 911 caller mentioned the word gun in a call for help he would later recant. 8 bullets, 2 guns, 1 dead boy, 1 question. Why? Kendrick McDade wasn't the first to ask that question. Not by bullets, but by cruel spikes driven into hands and feet by officers of the Roman law. Jesus' body hung on a cross as blood oozed from his wounds and his ragged breath began to fail him. With a final rally of strength, with one more painful breath, Jesus screamed into the darkness that had fallen around him, "My God, my God! Why have you forsaken me? Why? Why, God? Why do boys and girls, young men and women, have to keep on dying? Why do their bodies have to be riddled with bullets over and over and over again? Why does society pay lip service to the idea that all lives matter and then prove otherwise by the count of black and brown bodies that are left dead in the street? Why? Why have you forsaken us, God? The darkness is forming around us. Why? With every beating and every bullet, with every stop and every frisk, with every glance over his shoulder, every heartless and unkind word, I hear a hammer falling on a nail that tears through flesh and bone and lands with a sickening thud on the wood beneath. I hear the hammer and I hear a scream, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why? Why have you forsaken us, God? Where have you gone in our hour of trial? Where have you gone when a black boy lays dying on the pavement? Where have you gone when the grand jury says no true bill and another injustice makes it into the books unimpeded? Why have you forsaken us, God? My God, my God, where have you gone? Where have you gone, God, when the darkness falls, when the cross hovers between heaven and earth and love itself hangs dying on a tree? Where, my God, have you gone? Why have you forsaken me?" There's a crucifix, actually it's my favorite crucifix, that depicts Jesus' sacrificial death in a very unique way. It's called the Trinity Crucifix, and instead of displaying Jesus on the cross by himself, this particular crucifix gives an artistic representation of the entire Trinity present on the scene of Christ's execution. There's Jesus, obviously, on the cross, and above Jesus' head is the traditional image of the Holy Spirit as a dove. But the most interesting part of this crucifix is the way it depicts the first person of the Trinity. God the Father is behind Jesus with his arms around his body, tucked beneath his arms. The Father in this crucifix holds the Son up on the cross. We ask why. Why have you forsaken us, God? Where did you go? And God answers, "I'm at the cross. I'm holding that boy as he dies in the street. I'm weeping with the mama who will never hold her son again. I'm in the courtroom when they say it was justified." You see, the cross is God's definitive statement of solidarity with those who suffer. In the person of Jesus Christ, God allows every milliliter of evil and suffering that humankind can muster to spend its full force on his body, his psyche, and his soul. And from the cross, Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" God incarnate shares our dismay at the sheer brutal power of suffering, of violence, of evil. Suffering and evil, violence and death are so powerful they seem to overshadow even God. Everything lovely and beautiful shirks and shrinks and gives way. Every particle of creation recoils in horror horror and cowers in terror before the gruesome spectacle of a broken body hanging limp and lifeless from a cross, of a black boy's body bleeding his life away on the warm asphalt of a California city street. My God, my God, why have you forsaken us? Where did you go? Jesus, the God who dies alone and forsaken on the cross, shares our anguish, groan, our dismay, our rage, as sorrow and love commingle in the tears that drip from his bloody face and mangled beard. Jesus is God's love incarnate, the flesh and blood that brings God's love to humankind. He is the beaten and disfigured and pierced God. He is the God who suffers, who allows himself to be overwhelmed by suffering. My God, my God, where did you go? If you want to know where God is, look no further than Kendrick McDade's gunshot body lying in the street. If you want to know where God is, look into the bloodshot, weary, weeping eyes of a mother who will never see her baby boy open the front door again. If you want to know where God is, look at the cross. God is there.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying.
Because every time you see me, you want to harass me, you want to stop me, you want to stop me. I'm minding my business.
Bring some loving here today.
I'm minding my business, please just leave me alone. I told you last time, please leave me alone.
We don't need to escalate.
Hold on, hold on, hold on.
Don't touch me. Don't touch me.
War is not the answer. For all your love, you know we can't
let you. Put your hand, buddy. Put your hand, buddy. You can't breathe. You can't breathe. You can't breathe.
Picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? What's going on? Yeah, what's going on? Oh, what's going on?
Right now.
He was mocked and ridiculed,
emasculated and dehumanized, debased and stricken. He had countless opportunities to assert his humanity. So it doesn't quite square with me that he waited moments before his death to emphasize his mortality by saying, "I thirst." But this word in the Greek, dipsao, figuratively means those who are said to painfully feel their want of, to eagerly long for those things which the soul is refreshed, supported, and strengthened by. As Jesus hung on the cross in excruciating pain, there was an internal desire that he was in want of, that he longed for. There was an internal pain that superseded any whip or betrayal, denial, or beating that he had experienced. And so he said, "I thirst." Yeah. Like Jesus, Eric Garner was approached by a mob to arrest him on July 17, 2014. He too would be judged unjustly, sentenced unfairly, treated unmercifully, as he begged to be left alone and proclaimed his innocence. Even as he cried out for pity and looked for relief, repeatedly saying, "I can't breathe, I can't breathe," there was no one. He lay lifeless on the sidewalk for 7 minutes. No one performed CPR or offered any life-saving measures. The medical examiner ruled the death of Eric was a homicide by compression of the throat and chest. Now you may watch that video and believe that an injustice was committed that day, and it was. But for Eric and too many others, an injustice was committed long before July 17, 2014. It wasn't the grip of Officer Pantaleo, but the grip of a broken and inhumane criminal justice system that allowed Eric Garner, the father of six, to be arrested 30 times by the age of 43 for petty misdemeanor crimes. When I think about that, I can't breathe. When I think about living in a place where freedom is commodified, sold on a bench by corrupt judges, poorly defended by prejudiced prosecutors, and commonly commandeered by crooked cops, it's hard to breathe. I've witnessed those who are hungry receive poison for food, and those who are thirsty receive vinegar to drink. I've witnessed the disproportion and unfairness in how our laws are legislated and enforced. But the life-stealing grip and death-dealing clutch of injustice happens many years before they make it to the streets. Yes. They're being choked out in the schools from inadequate and inequitable access to education, choked out in the ways we teach and the ways we test and assign value to our children at very young ages, choked out by systems of education that don't teach their history, that don't affirm their lives, and that don't support their heritage. They're choked out by indistinct systems of racism and prejudice, hatred and bigotry that are tantamount to cultural genocide, identity disassociation, gender inequality, and homophobia. Society placed them in an illegal chokehold long ago. It's not just Officer Pantaleo who's guilty of choking the life out of somebody. But when the Christian missionaries travel to other countries and strip them of what it is meant to be uniquely distinct and indigenous, convert them under sword and bow, deem their rituals and practice demonic and pagan, they apply and give it to God. When zealots and fanatics in Indiana and Arkansas craft and pass religious freedom bills that legalize discrimination of same gender-loving individuals under the guise of the First Amendment, none of us can breathe. For me, there's a relationship between the words of Christ and the words of Eric. Christ wanted us to know that although my back is beaten, my head is bludgeoned, and my body is bloody, I thirst. My will and strength to see the oppressed set free is not broken. My passion and desire for those abused and neglected is not diminished. Oh. I thirst because children are being trafficked in the streets. I thirst because women in America still make 70 cents for every dollar a man makes. I thirst because 12-year-old Tamir Rice was viewed as a threat to be exterminated. I thirst because Eric Garner cannot breathe. I thirst because 65% of black households in America are choked out by low incomes, unemployment, and poverty. I thirst because stop and frisk is legal on the streets of New York. I thirst because discriminatory immigration laws run rampant in Arizona. I thirst because the church is too afraid of prophetic preaching. I thirst because while people lay in the street dead from society's assessment of them? How will we respond to those who are victims of a world that has strangled the life out of them? How can we thirst in a world where so many people can't breathe?
Calvin Andre Reed died in a hospital after an encounter with police in Florida. His parents, who live in Simpsonville, call the incident a cover-up as they try to get answers. Andre Reed's parents say it took several days to get basic information about their son's death, and they still don't know exactly what happened to him.
When Mamie Reed got the call, she says everything just stopped.
He was just very special, had a wonderful personality. He didn't meet strangers. He was everything to us.
She would never get a chance to speak to her son, Calvin Andrelius Reed, again.
It was like someone had totally ripped out my heart.
Even now, flipping through family pictures is difficult.
I don't know when we will be able to realize that he's not coming back.
Once they got there, it said that he refused attention. In turn, they called the Coconut Creek Police Department.
Police say Andre exhibited threatening behavior and was repeatedly asked to stop resisting them, but they say he refused to comply, and that's when he was tased.
Said that they tased him three times, and through different information, evidently he was tased more than that.
The Reeds say witnesses at the complex say they saw an officer hit Andre with a stick-like object.
I think they should be removed from their job until this is settled.
Calvin Reed says 2 days later, they got a call from police that Andre went into cardiac arrest and died at a hospital.
Hello. My name is Calvin Reed. I'm going to tell you what I know, at least what I remember. Nobody will really know why I showed up to that condo complex that night. It had been a long ass night. My eyes were burning and my skin was stinging and my good white shirt was stained with blood. A white man came around the corner and I asked him to help me, to drive me to the hospital. He didn't know what was wrong with me, and rightfully so, he told me no. I asked him if he would at least call 911, and he said yes. And then I asked him if he'd wait with me until paramedics arrived, and he said no, he had somewhere to be. So I sat and I waited for the paramedics to come, and they came. That didn't go so well. All the questions and prodding and poking, I just needed a minute to get my bearings, you know? They saw that I was clearly in need of help with my tattered and bloody clothes. Things just didn't go right. And they called the police on me. Afraid of something, I guess. Afraid of what? I don't know. The cops get there and they see me cut up and dirty with beads of sweat forming at my temples. I'm sure there were words. Hell, I know there were words, but it's real hard to remember what happened next. Grass against my face. Cold and prickly. A cop yells, "I'll break your arm!" Cheap plastic against my skin. tight and digging. I don't know why they hit me in my head. It hurt like hell. My face in the grass, cold and prickly. Breathing hurts. There are feet coming towards me, one in front of the other, small like a lady's boot. Cops ask her who she is, and she don't know me and can't help me, but I make an attempt anyway.
They're gonna kill me! They're gonna kill me!
I feel the ground leaving my body. Officers resurrected me from my cold, from the cold ground to my feet. I don't know if it was the adrenaline or the fear or the ringing in my ears from being hit with a billy club, but I took two steps forward. One, two. Too much advancement for them, I guess. One bolt of lightning, bah! Two bolts of lightning, bah!
I can't breathe! They're gonna kill me!
In John 19, verse 30, Jesus' final words in the Johannine text culminated a life's work. His words brought to a close thousands of years of prophecy that had been waiting in the balance for that particular moment in time. His words, "It is finished," brought to an end of all suffering and trouble and bothersome things, all things that once were now at an end. Scripture says that this day will come, the day where Jesus would hang from a tree with clothes casted for lots without a broken bone. Many have prophesied that the Messiah, the Son of God, would come and die for the sins of the world and reconcile all of us back to God, even those of us who would go kicking and screaming on the way. Finished. The Greek translation says that finish translates as the last act, which completes a process to accomplish or to fulfill completely. Jesus' last words in John 19, then, is the fulfillment of prophecy. And what of Calvin's words? If Jesus' words fulfill prophecy, bringing to a close to what we all knew was coming, Calvin's words were prophetic, then, speaking to what was to come. Calvin called out to anyone who would hear in the prophetic that his death was soon coming. He called out a warning, a clarion call that death would soon come upon him. His words would echo out into the annals of history and pick up momentum with every shot of that taser. His heartbeat would become irregular and could not take a totality of three electric volts to a body that had already been traumatized. It is here, right here, that we hold in tension prophecy and fulfillment. The in-between place, as Calvin waited for prophecy to be fulfilled, so that he may meet a Savior who had already fulfilled prophecy. In tension we hold the prophetic calling and the fulfillment of prophecy, both realized in and through death.
They are going to kill me!
It is finished.
They are going to kill me!
It is finished.
They are going to kill me.
It is finished. Words of fulfillment will become words of comfort for 39-year-old Calvin Reed as his perspired face would water the prickly grass under.
prophecy and fulfillment leaves us face down in prickly grass with beads of sweat watering its roots.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more backward thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be.
This young woman's family have learned new details of her tragic death, but the more they find out, the more upset they're getting. On the edge tonight, a woman shot dead, her body dumped, her family devastated. But now police say it may have been just a tragic mistake. They say that someone killed her because they thought she was a criminal.
This man just came to the door by somebody just knocking. She didn't break in his house. She didn't break a window. What, you seen somebody on your porch and you just started shooting? And then you say it was accidental? That wasn't accidental. That wasn't accidental. No.
19-year-old Renisha McBride is dead. Police telling us she took her last breath on this porch on Outer Drive in Dearborn Heights.
The world won't get no better. We gotta change again, just you and me.
Wake up all the doctors, wake the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the
and who
hell.
Catch all the hell.
They don't have so very long.
I want to go home. Those were the last words spoken by Renisha McBride. I want to go home. How many of us have uttered these same words? In times when we are tired and weary, when we're out in places we no longer want to be, we say we want to go home. But what is this home that we desire? The dictionary defines home as a place where one lives permanently, especially as a member of a family or household. But I think that home is a little something more. Home is a place of comfort and love, safety and security. For some, that involves direct family members, and for others, it may be close friends, and still others, it is a church community that we are a part of. That cold early morning, Renisha was seeking safety. She was seeking home. In the early hours of November 2nd, 2013, Renisha McBride was involved in a car accident. Witnesses claim she was bleeding and confused from the accident. For 2 hours, she wandered the streets, disoriented and hurt, murmuring, "I want to go home." She eventually ended up on the porch of Theodore Wafer, seeking help. But instead, she was met with the barrel of a shotgun. In Wafer's own defense, he said he feared for his life when he heard loud banging on his door very early in the morning. And in that moment, Wafer decided to let his fear take over. He did not see Renisha as a daughter or a niece or a beloved child of God. He saw a black body that needed to be put down. And so he took his gun and he shot her through the door. It was his fear that led to Renisha's death. It is the same fear that leads to the death of so many black and brown bodies in America. You see, America is not a true home for black and brown bodies. Many times it is not a place of safety or comfort or rest. Instead, it is a place filled with racism and sexism, homophobia, discrimination, and the dehumanization of our very lives. There is a pervasive fear of blackness in America. The hue of my skin makes me a threat. And that fear, that threat, is followed by violence, whether through actions or words. Right here in Atlanta, Anthony Hill was killed by police just a few short weeks ago. He was a veteran with documented mental illness. He was armed only with the darkness of his skin, but the officer deemed that enough. He was threat enough to put 2 bullets into him and end his life. Every 28 hours, another black body perishes from this fear. This fear, however, is contrary to the gospel that we all proclaim. The gospel that calls us into a radical hospitality, that calls us to move past fear and invite people in, especially those on the margins and deemed less than. Yes. Time and time again, we see a Christ that invited people into his home, his family, and his community, and we are called to do the same. During this Holy Week, we are on a journey with Christ as he prepares for his own crucifixion and resurrection. I imagine a Christ that is battered and bruised, that not unlike Renisha is disoriented and hurt from the burden of the cross that he carries. A Christ that is looking for his home and a place to rest. A Christ that understands he must endure pain and suffering like so many of us do today. Yet even in his last moments, in his moments of hurt and despair, Christ was still inviting people into his community. In the Gospel of Luke, we see a Christ that even on the cross turned to the criminal next to him to remind him, "You will be with me in paradise." You see, in God's home, in God's community, there is always room. The door is always open. There is no fear. All who labor, all who are hurt and lost and confused, who are looking for rest, are welcome. God opens the door for us all, and if we are called to follow Christ, we must also open the door. Jesus committed himself to this. Unto the death, Jesus went so we could have a home, a place of safety and rest in the eternal kingdom of God. As I close, I'm reminded of the story of Lazarus and the rich man. Lazarus had lived a hard life of illness and hunger, and he sat at the door of the rich man's house begging for refuge. But the rich man ignored Lazarus. And when they both died, Lazarus was taken with the angels up to be with Abraham, while the rich man went to hell. Renisha, like Lazarus, has been carried up with the angels. She is finally home in a place where she has rest and comfort. We, however, are not there yet, and there is work to be done here. Black and brown bodies are still slain out of fear. People continue to be afraid to stand up and proclaim that black lives matter. And our churches remain silent in the face of injustice. We must not be like the rich man who steps over Lazarus every day as we come and go. We must go against the world and choose a God that is calling us home. We are called to the radical hospitality of the gospel that urges us to push past our fears and into the grace of God. We understand that God stands with the marginalized even more than he stands with the powerful, and that we can no longer cower behind our own fears, that we must invite all into our homes and our communities. Renisha's last words echoed a sentiment we all feel, a longing to be home. It is a sentiment that even Christ uttered on the cross, a longing to be in true communion with God. So let us remember to open the door, to create spaces of love and grace, of safety and of healing. For when we push past our fears, we encounter the living, loving God that is calling us all home.